In the last video, we saw how to implement a state machine to control the behavior of our units. And also, we gave our units a detection system that allows them to detect nearby enemies. Now, on this video, we are going to see how to implement a system that allows our units to follow other units around. The scene is pretty much the same as before. There are no new elements and there are no new components on our objects. As you can see, we have the unit manager. Our units have the same child objects, the text for the state, the detection system, and there is only one little enemy down here who also have a detection system, but we are not going to use that on this video. Anyway, to implement this following system, we only have to modify three scripts, which are the root script, which is the one that has the state machine, and the move input script, and the actual movement script. So let's see what we have to do. In the root script, the only thing we have to do is to add following as a possible state of our state machine. The rest of the script is the same as before. Our move input script is the one that is going to be much more modified than before. First, on the variables, we have a new reference to the root script of the currently selected unit. And in the initialization of the script, we assigned a value to this variable using our newly made getSelectedKeyRoot function, which is at the bottom of the script. So let's take a look at it. Here we have our getSelectedKeyRoot function. As you can see, it's just a switch statement that, depending on the selected unit, it tracks the objects of that unit by its tag, as you can see here, and it gets the root script component of that unit. That's everything this function does. Okay, now back to the top of our move input script. The update function of this script is pretty much the same. The only difference is that in here, where we gave the unit all the commands for it to move, we now have a function named move to point. And this function is just the same commands we used before, and the only purpose of this function is to have our code a little bit cleaner, so we don't have to repeat the same chunk of code two times, or as many times as you have units in your game. Now we have the same two functions that our buttons use to select the unit, with only one single extra line of code, which is a call to the getSelectedKeyRoot function, which updates the selectedKeyRoot reference to the root script of the currently selected unit. So every time you change unit, this line of code updates the variable that keeps track of the root script of the selected unit. These two new functions are going to be the ones that will allow our units to enter the following state and will assign the target they are going to be following. So let's see how this works in our scene. Remember the event trigger component of our units? Well, this is where we are going to use those new follow functions. Before, we had the functions select 1 and select 2 in each of our units, but now we are going to use those new functions, follow 1 and follow 2. Follow 1 for the first unit and follow 2 for the second unit, as you can see here. The buttons of the UI are still going to work with the select 1 and select 2 functions that we had before. Now that this new function is assigned to the event trigger component of our unit, it is going to be executed when we click on the units themselves directly with our mouse. And when we click On the buttons, we are still going to be using the old select functions. But if we click on a unit, then we get to use the following, or the follow one and follow two functions. So let's check how the code of those functions work. The first thing the follow function does is to check if the unit you are clicking on is not the currently selected unit, because we don't want a unit to follow itself. So if you click on the same unit, nothing of the code of the follow function will be executed. So the next thing we have to do on the follow function is, of course, to update the state of the unit from whatever state it was to the following state. And also we are going to assign the new transform the unit is going to be following by this line of code. We get the movement script component of the unit, and on a new variable we will see in a bit, we are going to put the transform of the unit that the currently selected unit is going to follow, and the last line of code actually is the one that updates the currently selected unit to the one the player just clicked. Okay, now what's really happening from a unit's point of view is, if you are not clicking on myself, then I'm going to change my state to following. You are going to give me the transform I'm going to be following, and after that this currently selected unit changed. On the movement script, we have three new variables. A new transform, which is clear following. This is going to be the transform the unit is going to follow. We have a float, which is the distance that needs to be between the units when they are following each other. And a reference to the sprite render of the pointer of the unit. The initialization, we have one new line of code, which only gets the sprite render of the pointer of the unit. Now, for the update function of the movement script. When the unit state is moving, it is going to behave the same as before. But now, when the unit state is following, we are going to execute this piece of code right here. First thing we have to do is to update the pointer position to make it follow the transform that the unit is going to be following. And also, we have to enable the pointer sprite so it is now visible. The next thing we have to do is to calculate the distance between the unit and the transform it is following. And if that distance is greater than our following distance, we use the nav mesh agent component to move towards the position of the transform we are going to be following. Now, if the distance is not greater than the following distance, then we stop our movement. And finally, this last conditional over here only has the function to disable the sprite of the pointer when we are not in the following state or in the moving state. One last thing, remember that when using a state machine, all your states need to follow an order of priority between them. In this case, the following state takes priority over the idle state, but the following state does not take priority over the combat state. So if the unit that was following another that was in a follow state comes close to an enemy and enters the combat state, it is going to stop following whatever it was following. And that's it. That's everything you need to do to implement this following system. And on the next video, we are going to be giving our units stats like HP, defense, and attack, and implementing a basic melee attack. Thanks for watching, and if you have any questions, leave them on the comments.